reitero mi más sincero agradecimiento.
Bueno, muchas gracias, Nicolás. Como digo, estoy aquí encantado. Voy a hacer una charla que quiero que sea un poco una umbrella, ¿no? un paraguas bajo el cual tocar algunos de los temas que vamos a discutir en estos días. No other story than the invention of the Virgin of Guadalupe in Mexico better represents the possibilities but also the tensions that the culture of religious images experimented in the construction of the early modern world. It's very well known, the origins of the Virgin of Guadalupe are still covered by shadows. We all have heard, of course, of the increasing devotion that it attracted, especially since the late 16th century, how a certain native called Juan Diego was surprised to discover it painted in the interior of the tilma, in which the Virgin herself had told him to collect flowers in the hill of Tepeyac, how it became the symbol of an emerging Creole identity, and now how it has become the most visited, maybe actually the most visited, a sanctuary in the whole world. The legend is quite recent, produced maybe as much as only one whole century after the image itself. But the story of its origins, at least when it comes out of the oldest documents, is not one of miraculous discovery and triumphal epiphany, but one of conscious invention and contested production. And what is more important for our purpose in the following days, this image, Guadalupe, deepens its roots in the Christian tradition of image making, where at the same time, this was reinvented to adapt to a completely new political landscape. Actually, the first time the Virgin of Guadalupe appears in the documents is in the context of a polemic. Sometime in the year 1555, the Archbishop of Mexico, Alonso de Montúfar, preached on the miracles that people said the Virgin of Tepeyac was performing. Montúfar compared the image to some old shrines in the Iberian Peninsula, like the Virgins of Montserrat and La Peña de Francia. But at the same time, planting sacred images in a land of conversion, in this case New Spain, was not something new to Montúfar. A native of Loja, the Dominican Montúfar had spent most of his life in the Granadan convent of Santa Cruz La Real before arriving to Mexico in 1554. He was actually in his 50s when he first moved to Mexico. In Granada, he had assisted to the making and distribution of images of the Virgin for the new consecrated mosques. Images, and they were done in serial production, images that would soon develop their own personality and in many cases, miraculous identity. These are some cases. Montúfar's promotion of Guadalupe was then for old and new at the same time, as old and new was the polemic it carried. Immediately after Montúfar's eloquent defense of the miraculous painting, a Franciscan friar gave in response some inflamed sermons that have only come to us fragmentary. Francisco de Bustamante, the Franciscan, his name, not only attacked the authority of the new image, it even questioned a new evangelization policy that was making of images in themselves objects of belief. And I'm quoting Bustamante's sermon. One of the worst things that could be done to the new Christian natives would be to make them believe in Our Lady of Guadalupe, because since their conversion, it has been told to them they should not believe in images, but only in God and Our Lady. And to tell now the Indians that an image painted by an Indian performs miracles would be great confusion and the undue good that had been planted here, end quote. Bustamante's resistance to a practice that he obviously saw as an invitation of idolatry is one that resuscitates long debates held in the Catholic Church since the middle of the 14th century on this issue of image adoration. Debates that had its own roots in the Iberian Peninsula in the context of interreligious conflicts, but that went renovated or became renovated as a result of the Protestant Reformation. This debate on images critically revisited the role of icons in what I will be calling today the, and this is going to be my key word today, the economy of the sacred. So before I move forward, and maybe economy of the sacred could have been the title for my presentation today, just let me say a word about what I mean with this word economy, as the word acquired a new specific meaning in Christianity since the epistles of Paul. In the letters of Paul, economia was not anymore restricted to the administration of goods or the trade between individuals, the oikos, right, the family, but to the communication between man and God. Economia, in this Christian tradition, refers to the divine plan of salvation. In his words to the Ephesians, the mystery hidden for ages in God. As Maria José Montzen has written in an important but also provocative book, the theology of the image, and therefore images themselves, became a substantial and operative instrument for this economy of salvation, a way to bridge the human with the divine, the spiritual with the corporeal. And I'm translating this quotation, the economy has wanted to be founded on all levels of our attachment both to the unity of the divine plan, right? Equally careful of the salvation of our bodies and of our souls. Body and souls became just one the same thing. So divine economy, however, became an important element of dispute at the moment of the fragmentation of the church at the beginning of the 16th century. Whether nailed or glued at the door of a church in Wittenberg, or just sent to the Archbishop of Mainz, Albert von Brandenburg, that we will probably never know. What we do know is that those 95 theses published the 31st of October, 1517, of which we now today celebrate the 500th anniversary, these theses became or had a fundamental role in the transformation of Christianity, with dramatic consequences in the history of visual culture, even on the emergence of what had just started to be called art, with capital A, at both sides of the frontier opened up by the Reformation. Economy was no question an important part of the thesis of Luther that Luther posted in Wittenberg. They incorporated a fierce attack on the indulgences, the financial and social edifice of the church, which allowed to trade prayers for the time the dead had to spend in purgatory. In this particular time and place, as we all know, in relation to the rebuilding of St. Peter's, for which the Dominican Johannes Tetzel was raising money in its immediacy. And I quote, this is of course Luther. "Why does not the Pope, whose wealth is today greater than the riches of the richest, build just in one church of St. Peter with his own money, rather than with the money of poor believers? They preach men who say that so soon as the penny jingles into the money box, the soul flies out of purgatory." Those are Luther's words. Luther did not develop, and this, by the way, is a drawing by Hemskerk, and we'll be looking into his prints in a moment. Luther did not develop a critique of images themselves, but he did something which was much more important. He removed images from the spiritual economy of the church. These in two different while complementary ways. On the one hand, by criticizing their involvement in ritual and devotional practices like pilgrimages that he considered intrinsically superstitious. Images, as one could read in the Old Testament, are powerful, maybe too powerful. They enchant and divinize the world, as Luther would write in 1520, they lead people by their nose. On the other, Luther undermined images' aura by making them only vicarious to the only authority of the word, that is, to the authority of Scripture. Faith, more than ever before in Christianity, was now only to come out of listening to the word, not by seeing him in an image. Faith only came ex auditu, from the ear, as Paul had preached to the Romans. Interestingly enough, when Lucas Cranach looked for a visual symbol that would envision Luther's Theologia Crucis, he found no better one than the paradoxical episode of the brazen serpent described in the Israelites' travel to the Promised Land, the Book of Numbers. The same serpent whose poisonous bite killed the people of God in their exodus through the wilderness was to be set up in the middle of their camp. Moses invited the Israelites to stir the serpent set on the top of a pole, and when they looked at it, they were immediately healed. But healing came by looking into an image that was twice paradoxical. It was the same image that had brought sickness to their people, and it had nothing of the whorish, seductive beauty of the popish idols. In the Weimar altarpiece, for example, finished by Lucas Cranach the Younger in 1556, the same year, by the way, when the Virgin of Guadalupe polemically entered history. These things are happening simultaneously, and that I find particularly interesting. The brazen serpent features on the side of the crucifixion, right behind the head of the painter himself, in between those of John the Baptist and Luther. While a stream of blood coming out of Christ's side wound sprinkles onto his head, hope you can see it. The artist, while this is happening, the artist, Cranach, is not looking to the sacramental body of Christ, but instead stares directly to the viewer. For figures, Luther had said or written, are not fulfilled when seen, but only when we believe in what they represent. As Carlos Eyre has established in what has become a classic, and I'm tempted to call it the Bible of the debate on the Reformation and the images. If Bible was not such a controversial word in this context, right? But I would call it the Bible. As Carlos Eyre has established for the debate of images in Germany, Luther's understanding of this issue remained conservative, if not ambiguous. It did not take long, however, for his former colleague at Wittenberg University, Andreas Karlstadt, to turn this into a furious invitation to the destruction of images that was to burst out in Saxony and soon to spread into different parts of Europe. No matter how Luther opposed his former supporter, Karlstadt, with the argument that images could not be extirpated with the power of the law, but only could be extirpated with the spiritual power of the gospel, that's what Luther told Karlstadt, episodes of iconoclasm soon became part of the Reformation's history. Maybe the highest peak would come half a century later, around the time when the Archbishop Montúfar was inventing the Virgin of Guadalupe in the faraway Mexico, and again in a territory now under the dominion of the Catholic monarchy, in this case the Netherlands. The day of St. Lawrence, August the 10th, 1566, the mob, led by a hat maker, improvisedly turned into a preacher, the mob sacked and completely destroyed all religious images in the parish church in Antwerp. In the following weeks, alone in Flanders, over 400 churches were pillaged. Hogenberg's famous print shows the Calvinists pulling down the statues from their pedestals with the long ropes, and breaking stained glass windows under the quite unpermissive contemplation of the local authorities. I think that Hogenberg was very interested in pointing out these details, right? The soldiers are all around, but they're doing nothing. As it had has repeatedly been noticed, the selected day for the insurrection, the feast day of St. Lawrence, was far from random, as it was under its protection that the kings of Spain, Philip II, had not only gained his famous battle against the French, but what was more important, it was under the protection of St. Lawrence that they had dedicated the construction of one of the most glorious foundations of its reign, the Royal Monastery of the Escorial, that we'll be visiting in the next days. And I will come back to this coincidence in a moment. For the first episodes of the soon-to-be-called Beldensturm, the image storm that desecrated the churches of the southern Netherlands from south to north the year 1566 with a devastating effect in its religious patrimony, the Beldensturm was first of all an act of desacralization, focused on the sacred while respecting all symbols of civic and princely power. That was not in the next years, but it was... most analyses coincide that this was actually what happened in those 1566-67 moments of the revolt. Contemporary witnesses would describe this as a ritual of carnivalesque inversion. In an often reproduced popular broadsheet, friars and clergy pray to a seven-headed hydra with the Pope on her back, while in the opposite side, the iconoclast beggars destroy and strip images and sacred vessels from the church. Both seem absorbed, equally absorbed, I would say, in their irrational activities, while a flying devil over their heads escapes with his booty, sarcastically saying, "To pray or to shit, it was all in vain." If iconoclasm was one major effect of the Reformation in the Netherlands, its repression became the very image of the Catholic Restoration. The famous but also short-lived 5-foot-tall triumphal sculpture of the Duke of Alba by Jacques Jogelink, cast for the Plaza, had an old, very well-known model of the victory over the fury, which was now identified with iconoclasm. A monstrous hydra under the feet of the Duke holds an axe, a hammer, a torch, even a booklet that tools that is the tools for image destruction. I think that's fascinating. This little book, right, which is equally dangerous in these situations as the hammer or the axe. A fascinating outcome of the Beldenstorm, which still puzzles art historians, was the explosion of iconoclastic imagery. And this is a question of that I think I would like to bring to our discussion, which is the open meaning of these prints, which is the scholars are still struggling with it. And I think it's a question that would be for someone like Peter Parshall, I guess, to answer, but not certainly myself. I just want to present the question. So artists like the Dutch Maarten van Heemskerk, who had explored the subject since his early visit to Rome, and we're now seeing the destruction of the idol of Bel, worshipped by the Babylonians, produced in the late 1560s prints that are an unquestionable response to the traumatic episodes. This I like. Taken from rarely represented biblical stories, Heemskerk's prints systematically illustrate the removal of idols with a language that brings immediately to mind Hogenberg's Just Seen Imagery. And it's funny that in this case, Heemskerk placed this episode of iconoclasm in the interior of the Pantheon, which was the symbol, right, of the of the pagan of a pagan temple dedicated to all the gods. And of course, Calvin at this time was mentioning this as the kind of the source of inspiration of a never interrupted idolatry in Rome from the time of the Romans to the time of the popes. But that time, the time of this print was made, Hogenberg was already had already found refuge as a Protestant in Cologne, while Heemskerk was still in Haarlem, but only for brief, as he would only flee the city, leaving for Amsterdam when the Spanish troops besieged his town. So, I mean, and this, I think, it's also a big question. I mean, it's how the Reformation facilitated a new mobility for artists, and I will again go back to this in a moment. In some of these prints, like the story of Atalaya, dated right after the Beldenstorm ignited in Antwerp, the destruction of the idols happens in the interior of a classical temple built with classical orders, decorated with niches holding monumental sculptures, which recycles Roman prints in a polemical manner. Here's what I think it's recycling. Raphael's School of Athens in particular. The Roman connotations of this Roman idolatrous architecture seems to have served polemical purposes. As Konrad Jonkherre has recently argued in what I believe are some of the most provocative studies being written on this subject, the reference to Raphael's architecture is more explicit even in a painting by the Protestant artist Hans Vredeman from Fries, dated 1567, today in Bremen. The painting now brings a very significant moment. We are in Lystria, the Acts of the Apostles 14th. We are in Greece, where St. Paul and Barnabas have arrived to preach Christianity. Seeing one miraculous healing at the Temple of Zeus, the people of Lystra take Paul and Barnabas for, and I quote, gods in human form, bringing them offerings and even wanting to sacrifice to them oxen. Vredeman turns the story into one of idolatry, with the scene happening in the interior of a magnificent classical temple with monumental sculptures in grisaille, just like those pulled down in the prints that we've seen, all the sculptures filling completely the niches. The placing of St. Paul's story in the architecture of the School of Athens makes absolute sense, as Raphael's story in the architecture of the School of, makes absolute sense as Raphael's composition was known in the Netherlands and most probably in the rest of Europe too through a engraving printed in Antwerp that identified the scene not as the School of Athens but as St. Paul preaching in the Areopagus. Not anymore a story of Christian humanism but of Paul's preaching to conversion in a land of paganism. In Verdeman's adaptation of this theatrical setting, just like the people of Lystra take the apostle of the Gentiles to be a living god, which is what Vredeman seems to be arguing, Christians make of the marble sculptures their mute idols. The magnificent Roman architecture of this idolatrous temple acquires in this way obvious polemical overtones, a critique on both the extravagant expenditure of its Roman church, its material economy, as well as on the corrupted spiritual economy of its system of mediations. And I think there are both sides of the same coin, right? The spiritual and the material. And this opens another interesting question that I pass down to Agustín Bustamante and Fernando Marías, which is that not many years later, in the monastery of San Lorenzo at the Escorial, in one of the first paintings commissioned for the Royal Basilica, the royal painter Navarrete el Mudo would use just the same composition and narrative identification to paint a Saint Paul, now escorted with Saint Peter. They're actually identified, right? This operation Christianizes this pagan model, now filling all niches of this magnificent architecture with the images of saints. So I think there's some sort of a kind of conscious replacement of gods by saints in a context of polemics. But this, of course, was not the only possible response. At the other side of the religious border, precisely that same year, an artist that remained on the Catholic side, Michel Coxkie, painted one of the most spectacular altarpieces of that moment, a painting that can be taken as a response to Vredeman's argument. I'm referring to the last chapter triptych, painted in 1567 for the Church of St. Michael and Gudula. Again, Michel Coxkie remained faithful to the Catholic Church and to the Duke of Alba. This painting was commissioned to replace another altarpiece that went destroyed during the Beldensturm, at a chapel actually dedicated to the relic of a desecrated host that had miraculously bled centuries before when stabbed by a Jew. The painting, we could say, has iconoclasm, two eyes inscribed into its own history. An artist from Mechelen who had spent many years in Rome but returned in the late 1540s to work as a court painter for the Habsburg regent Mary of Hungary, Michel Coxkie developed a highly eclectic, even atemporal style filled with direct quotations to the works of the great Italian masters, from Titian to especially Raphael. During the stay of Prince Philip in the Netherlands, later Philip II in Brussels, Coxkie captivated the prince's attention and started to paint for the Spanish court, and he continued to do that in the following years. It is actually thanks to Coxkie's masterful copy that the Crossbowers Guild in Ghent acceded to let go to Madrid Rogier van der Weyden's The Position of Christ today in the Prado. So this is Coxkie's painting. This is Rogier van der Weyden's painting at the Prado. We can see that, I think it's tonight. And this is Coxkie's. Amazing. And many of his best works are therefore to be found today in the Royal Monastery. And I am only mentioning this example because it raises to me an interesting question, again, something to be discussed maybe in the following days, which is how is it possible that the iconoclasm, the hate of images, and a new form of idolatry, the love of art, emerged as simultaneous phenomena in Spain, in Europe in these mid-16th century years, right? Coxkie remained faithful to the King of Spain, and paintings at the Prado, like the Swedish Saint Cecily, were offered and acquired by the Duke of Alba before he was called back to Spain, bringing to an end the unsuccessful bloody repression. This was one of the paintings that the Duke of Alba loved. The Last Supper triptych features a temple very much like the classic classical architecture depicted in the just-seen panels and prints. But now the scale is being corrected. It looks no less magnificent, with the Last Supper taking place in the interior of a monumental church or temple, but now at a human scale. More surprisingly, the niches are all empty. On the right-hand side of the panel, there is a big dresser, the traditional sideboard used for the display of the luxurious tableware, here escorting the golden chalice with which Christ is celebrating. I think you can see it on the top right, right? This careful balance of richness and sobriety, the magnificence of a classical setting in which the only saints are the living images of Christ and his disciples celebrating with the same costly vessels that had been robbed or destroyed during the revolt, constitutes a thoughtful strategic defense of the economy of the Roman Church. So there was an insistence in the prince at the time of breaking down this, now breaking these sacred vessels. This becomes explicit, I think, under the light of the prominent Hebrew inscriptions written on the wall. And only in this particular detail, I am now departing from the otherwise beautiful interpretation of the painting by Jong Herre. And I would like to thank Jonathan Glaser here in the room with us for his help with the translations. The one closer to the sideboard, to our right, comes from Exodus 20, from the introductory words of the Decalogue. And he says, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery, which in the Hebrew Bible continues with the prohibition of iconic representations that would become the second iconoclastic commandment in Calvin's Decalogue. But the words of the image prohibition at the beginning of the Decalogue are not written in the painting. Instead, what we see is the image of Christ surrounded by his disciples. The inscription that follows just over Jesus' head has the previous words from the same passage in the book of Exodus. And I quote, and God spoke all these words, nothing else. Image and text convey in my eyes a clear meaning, for the words spoken by God do not refer now only to the efficacious words of Jesus and following Jesus of the Roman clergy during the act of the consecration, but also, of course, to Jesus himself as the living Logos. The painting builds on the position of the law, the Decalogue, and the Spirit, turning the latter, the Spirit, into the living image of God. That's what we're seeing, right? And this is why there are no images in the niches, just the living ones around the table. And this, at least, would be my suggestion. With the painting of the Last Supper, Coxkier composed simultaneously a defense of images and of the Eucharist itself, both under the attack of the Calvinist beggars, as much as a fundamental element of the, again, the economy of the Catholic Church. So now I am getting all over the place, I know, but let me just suggest other areas in which I think these same problems could be explored in the future. So let me now move to Spain. And I'll move into my own research because I think the examples could be useful. Coxkier had been most probably a student of Baron van Orlai, the Romanist painter in the court of Margaret of Austria. But also trained in Orlai's workshop had been another artist, in my opinion, no less complex, subtle, and sophisticated, who started his career in Brussels, followed Coxkier to Italy, but then moved to Seville, where he would spend 20 years of his life before finally returning to Brussels under quite mysterious circumstances, to which I will come back in a moment. But let me first introduce one of his most beautiful paintings, one whose story shares some interesting coincidences with Coxkier's Holy Supper. If Coxkier's had been painted to replace one of the several art pieces destroyed during Antwerp's Veldensturm, Peter Kempener's altarpiece of the Purification at the Cathedral of Seville went through no less violent circumstances. The 14th of March, 1560, short after it had been finished, as described in a document in the cathedral's archive, and I quote, many people entered the chapel, removed the altarpiece from its place with its veils and the tomb and candles and ornaments, and destroyed the altar, end quote. The altarpiece was miraculously saved, but all ornaments of the chapel are said to have gone destroyed. So there was a lot of violence around. And it seems funerary chapels were at this time something more than expressions of private devotion or Renaissance beauty. And I like this polemic to be brought for our analysis. Kempeners was the most gifted artist in Seville in the mid 16th century, and he obviously attracted some of the best commissions. This particular one came from Diego Caballero, the marshal of La Española, a man who had made a fortune with the industry of oyster gardening, Granjería de Perlas, in Cubagua, Nueva Cádiz, today Venezuela. Caballero had up to 84 native slaves, swimmers, diving in the Caribbean for the extraction of these precious jewels. And even had Kempener paint them prominent in the altarpiece, enormous, bending beautiful from the ears of his wife and daughters in the predella of the same retablo. I don't think this ever did exist, but at least look at those pearls. I mean, they're huge. uh, As he returned from the Americas in 1553, Caballero tried buying the funerary chapel for his family, but this proved very difficult. Everyone knew in Seville that the Mariscal was from a converso lineage, right? That is, that he had Jewish ancestors, and the Cathedral of Seville had long instituted pure blood statutes that prevented any individual with Jewish ancestry to be a member of the cathedral chapter. But Diego Caballero, you know, he was a very rich man, and I don't think the world has changed that much. So money can still buy everything, right? Or almost anything. But the chapel was not a bargain, as he had to overcome this strong anti-Semitic resistance of the cathedral's chapter. He ended up paying over 5,000 ducats for the chapel, on the top of the 600 that he had to pay Kempener for the altarpiece. That was a huge amount of money at the time. Before we look closer into the painting, and again, my only goal is to suggest ways in which the image debate issue can raise new questions for the visual culture of the Renaissance, let me say a few more words on the artist. So Peter Kempener was most probably trained, as we just said, in the workshop of Baron van Orlai. Kempener would have been exposed to a Lutheran critique of the Roman Church in his most immediate artistic circle. Why? Well, in 1527, his master, van Orlai, had been accused of hosting his house in Brussels the Lutheran Jacob van der Elst, who preached during Easter to a small selected group of people, among which there were several members of the artistic elite. Orlai had been forced to publicly recant and was punished with an economic fine, and he also, of course, would lose his position at the court of Margaret of Austria. A drawing in the Rijksmuseum in Amsterdam, unanimously attributed to his hand, depicts the abuse of the Catholic clergy, eloquently illustrating Orlai's sympathy towards the reform. In the center of the composition, a monk and cardinal are robbing the church's vessels. Behind him, Judas himself is selling benefices to a group of greedy clergy. Orlai's drawing would later actually be printed as part of the Reformed propaganda. That detail is in the middle of the print. So after leaving Brussels, just like Kocksky, Kempener also made his way to Italy, right? That would be done at the time, where he's briefly mentioned in Bologna and Rome before moving to Venice. According to the Settecentesque erudite Lanzi, Kempener worked in Venice for 20 years under the patronage of the Patriarch Grimani, most probably Cardinal Marino Grimani, whose collection of Roman antiquities and paintings left an important memory in the Flemish artist, and whose echo can clearly be seen in our painting, especially in one of his most famous pieces that belonged to his uncle, Cardinal Marino Grimani, the Falling Gaul, today in the Archaeological Museum in Venice. And it's obvious that it's not being taken from a print, first because I don't think that print exists, but also because it's being represented from the opposite right side, right? So he's actually made Nadher Hedleven, right, from life. Grimani, as we will later see, was not only an art collector, but a skilled theologian, very much committed with the defense of the Roman Church. Moreover, the miniatures of his commentary on the epistles of Paul, illustrating his understanding of the Catholic caritas, Catholic love, the subject of Kempener's painting, can be related to our altarpiece, as we will see in a moment. And I'm relying very much in my understanding of Grimani's world and the use of these debates to read these images through the word of Fabrizio Biferali here in the room, and Massimo Firpo, who finally couldn't make it for health reasons, because they have been exploring beautifully this world of Venetian religious polemics. And even Fernando Marias has written a beautiful article recently on a later episode of this, which is the relation of El Greco to the world of the Grimani, not this Grimani, but his brother. By 1537, Kempener had arrived to Seville, attracted by the wealth flowing from the Indies. Carpenters, sculptors, makers of stained glass windows, and of course, painters flowed into the city that held the control over the trade with the Indies since the beginning of the century. And I'm giving you the example of another artist, Ferdinand Sturm, Hernando de Sturmio, that I think is in very much need of a monograph. He came from the southern Netherlands, Zierikzee, had become actually a strong center of Anabaptism in the years right before he moved to Seville. Whether that is a coincidence or not, I have no idea. In fact, Modern northern painters like Storm or Pedro de Campaña dominated the civilian market well into the second half of the 16th century, where our artist would be now known as Pedro de Campaña. And Pedro de Campaña soon capitalized on most important commissions in town. Documented in the city until 1540 and again until 1546, and again since 1546 until he abruptly left in 1563, never to return to Seville. So he was sporadically in Seville for 20 years. According to his 17th century biographer, Pacheco, it was his colleague's envy that chased him out. But the moment of his leaving surprisingly coincides with the peak in inquisitorial repression in the city, which came often after artisans of foreign origin. In a series of autos de fe that took place in Seville between November 1559 and October 1562, dozens of French, English, and Flemish citizens were publicly relaxed, burnt at the stake, accused of importing Lutheran heresy into Seville. Closer to Kempener, one of the most important stained glass makers at the cathedral, the Flemish Carlos de Brujas, Carlos from Bruges, was publicly burned in November 1559. That same year, he had delivered his extraordinary window of the resurrection of Christ for the cathedral, which paradoxically, as it may seem, is still in place as some sort of a kind of an ominous memory, I believe, right? He has been speculated even that Campaña might have contributed to the cartoon of this window. Other artists, such as the Burgundian sculptor Guillermo Borgoñón from Burgundy, foiled Carlos de Brujas' fate shortly. And this should not come as a surprise. In fact, as Werner Thomas' studies have made clear, and I think this work has opened questions that art historians need still to fully explore, for the 16th century, he goes up to 1648, artisans, and I take this category in the broadest sense possible, from workers in the textile industry to painters or sculptors, artisans represented the 43% of those prosecuted by the Inquisition for heresy against, for example, less than 9% that would be peasants working in the agricultural industry, right? So, I mean, artisans were a big bunch of this problem. So we don't know if the reasons that brought these artists in particular to the stake was related to their heretical opinion on the cult of images. It is hard to think that it didn't, but the extant documentation doesn't allow us to know. What we do know is that the heterodox critiques on the value and cult of religious images that spread had spread in Seville with other reformed ideas imported from beyond the Pyrenees. We also know that these had been targeted, contested, and prosecuted, fostering a vigorous figurative religious culture that was to bloom in Seville in the next decades, or protecting it at least. Right? In fact, in the same auto de fe in which the artist Carlos de Brujas was executed in 1559, the effigies of two of the most famous Sevillian preachers burned with him at the stake. Dr. Egidio and Constantino Ponce de la Fuente, the first of the two, Dr. Gil or Dr. Egidio, a cathedral canon whose sermons became famous, even attracted the attention of the Emperor Charles V. And these two had been forced to retract from their heterodox positions in 1552. Recently dead, the effigy of Dr. Egidio was given now in this auto de fe to the fire. People had attended his sermons accused Dr. Gil of calling idolatrous the practices of the civilians, from the making of processions to the adoration of the Virgin Mary, and of course the cult of images. Out of the 10 statements from which Dr. Egidio was forced to publicly withdraw in 1552, two of them directly relate to the orthodox understanding of the cult of images. And this is these are the terms in which Dr. Egidio was forced to recant. And this the formula actually was to be remembered by the Inquisition later in time. Dr. Egidio said, "I say that the cross and the rest of the images do not only serve to help our memory like God's scripture and that of the saints whom we must adore, but being signs where God and the saints are represented, they have to be adored in themselves," end quotation. So this is exactly what he was forced to publicly say, withdrawing with his heterodox positions, right? The formula decided by the Holy Office has its roots in the teachings of Thomas Aquinas, but was, as far as I know, not adopted by the post-Tridentine Church elsewhere in Europe, less in the Council of Trent, whose famous 1563 decree on sacred images avoided this problematic, referring to what had been stated in the Seventh Council of Nicaea in the late 8th century. Egidius' heterodox attacks on images can be easily described as reflecting an Erasmian attack on superstition. More important, though, are those aspects in which the civilian canon, at least according to some witnesses, had preached on theses that the Holy Office considered to be Lutheran. And this is just a list of the things that he had said that were considered to be Lutheran. The justification by faith alone, on the one hand, and the relation of faith to charity, on the other. Aligned with the Protestant Reform, Egidio had preached that real faith necessarily produces charity, had defended the complete uselessness of giving alms in the absence of faith, and had even gone so far as to say that giving alms would be sinful itself in a state of mortal sin of the giver, right? The painting that Pedro de Campaña made for the Marshal of La Española seems to respond to this heterodox challenge while making use of some of the most of the figurative arguments that the artist had encountered in his travels. Let's look closer first into the painting. It is a commentary on the good works of charity, on the good works of charity, what they have to do in the economy of the church, right? But it is also a commentary on how this enters into the spiritual economy at a place, a funerary chapel, where regular masses would be given for the salvation of the soul of the marshal and that of the other members of his family. The scene of the presentation takes place in the Old Testament in Jerusalem, in the Old Temple in Jerusalem, here imagined as a classical building. Several women surround Simeon as he identifies the infant Jesus as the Messiah, seven to be exact. The allegories of the virtues of temperance, fortitude with the lion on her chest, hope and temperance. The other two virtues have a specific role, although for opposite reasons. The largest and most important of all virtues is the virtue of charity, depicted as a young matron, young woman giving her breast to little children. Caritas occupies a liminal position, about to leave the temple and coming into the street. Her left foot is still in the temple, while her toes, only the toes of her right foot, are touching the street. Charity is accompanied by a little boy holding an apple, which is about to give to a half-naked beggar on the street, modeled after the falling gold. And I have to say, intriguing that Campaña was using here a symbolic language, the allegory of charity, and the apple fruits, that is the same that artists of the Reformation were using for their own quite different understanding of Christian love. And I cannot fail to remember what I find even more paradoxical, that is that this was very much a battle over the meaning of Christian love, of caritas, right? The politics of love, to borrow a term from David Nuremberg. So the importance of charity is certainly nothing original for a painter that had worked so many years in Venice. As Tom Nichols has shown in a series of important studies, scenes of charity, giving alms in particular, figure prominently in Venetian stories of the time, what he interprets as a direct response to the Lutheran critique on their efficacious value. To give you one significant example, in Tintoretto's Jesus and the Adulterous Woman, the composition is framed by two naked beggars. The one in the right actually is even modeled after the same antique sculpture of the Falling Gaul from the Grimani collection. Campaña's painting just belongs to this imagery in defense of the indissolubility of faith and charity. Right? In the Sevillian painter, however, charity has surprising and, I think, polemical protagonism over faith. And this is not something unique, of course, but the other examples I know of are strikingly meaningful. One is a painting traditionally attributed to Pedro de Campaña himself, which is today in Mexico. This represents the seven virtues, the cardinal and the theological, in a tight group. In the center presides charity, in the traditional iconography of a woman giving her breast to two little children. On her left is hope, to her right faith is holding a cross and looking to her in a sign of approbation. The image of the primacy of charity over the rest of the virtues has no medieval precedent and was probably invented with a polemical anti-Lutheran intention. This, at least, is how my second example, a famous miniature by Giulio Clovio, has been interpreted. I'm looking at Flavio Bitferali here because I don't know what he is. He might raise his eyes saying, I disagree, but I'm going to suggest it anyway. It was made to illustrate the miniature one of Cardinal Marino Grimani's commentaries to the pieces of Paul, and according to Vasari, this miniature was sent to Spain soon after it was made. Don't know where it was, but it was definitely in Spain for at least two centuries. Before being sent to Spain, however, the miniature would have circulated in the circle of Michelangelo and Vittoria Colonna, as it is described in Francisco de Holanda's Dialoghi di Roma, being praised as the most beautiful example of its kind. The miniature shows faith and hope at both sides of an enthroned charity. With this in mind, let us return now to our painting for the last time. And my proposal will be to look into these paintings with a double mindset. One is that they are argumental, if not polemical, and the other is that they had a surprising kind of mobility or fluidity across the border built by the Reformation. This makes our work as art historians especially challenging, but also interesting, right? So charity steps out of the temple, out of the law, and into the era of grace, which lies beyond the liminal space at the foreground of the composition, connecting with the real space of the chapel in which it is placed, that is right over the altar. The primacy of charity over the rest of the virtues, an obvious reference to Paul's epistles to the Corinthians, is highlighted with one unique element, the representation of the seventh and last virtue in the whole composition, obviously faith, which is hovering behind the shoulder of Joseph, holding a cross as she points to the infant Jesus with her right hand. But faith here is an old maiden, hunchbacked by the weight of her old age. Faith, Campagna seems to be telling us, and this would be following how Dr. Egidius had been forced to recant, faith necessarily brings charity. Without love, faith is dead. So, but the challenge, and I'm moving now to my third and last part. I'm going to be brief now. But the challenge brought by the Reformation was to affect the role of images in what we have called the spiritual economy of the church in a much more direct way, and not only, if you might say, iconographical, like we've seen before, right? The example of Pedro de Campaña, again, is exemplary. As we've already remembered, the Holy Office had opposed the Reformed critique on the superstitious, even idolatrous Roman cult of images, arguing with the voice of the reprimanded canon Dr. Egidius that these images deserved the same quality of respect or cult as the reference, so to the image as to God, the same cult to the image as to what it represented. This promoted sacred images as privileged mediators of the church, investing old Marian icons with a new modern aura. Before finally fleeing, I'm going back to my example. So before fleeing Seville in 1562 to never return to the city, Campaña tried to adapt to what was an increasingly conservative market. In his first commission known, the painter from Brussels struggled to modernize a well-respected icon, the Virgen de los Remedios, to the new naturalistic expectations. But other patrons seemed less flexible. In the 1551 contract for a copy of the mural icon of Santa Maria de la Antigua, a miraculous image thought to predate the Islamic invasion, carefully determined that the artist had to respect form, width, scale, and factions of the original. And I think there will be one presentation by Maria Lumbreras, a grad student from Hopkins, if not today, tomorrow, on her research on this, some of these copies, which has brought, I think, incredibly interesting material for discussion. So, as in all contracts preserved, Campaña is called in these documents pintor de imaginería, painter of images, a category that, as far as I know, doesn't exist in Italy, neither in the Low Countries, but that was to survive in Seville for at least a century, so that no other than Diego Velázquez, for example, first received the guild's permission to open his own workshop in the city in the quality of pintor de imaginería, maker of images, which is kind of something amazing, I think. So, but the phenomenon, so there's a local aspect of this image polemic, but the phenomenon itself is far from being only civilian or Spanish, but it's actually a characteristic of post-Tridentine of post-Trinitarian Europe that's still to be, still, in my eyes, understudied. As John Calvin had stated in his polemical 1543 treatise on relics, the reason Marian icons reached the status of relics in the Catholic Church was because paintings were the only relics of the Virgin that existed in the Church, as it was widely believed. The dogma, as we all know, is only dated 1950, so day before yesterday, that Mary had bodily ascended spiritually, so in soul and body, she had ascended to heaven. So no other relics of the Virgin could have left behind but her icons. A famous, late, but extraordinary print by Gumpenberg in his Atlas Marianus illustrates this principle. Mary Mediatrix, the mediator by definition, ascends to heaven flying on her holy house of Nazareth. Her portraits form the roof of the house, and these are perfectly mirrored in heaven. Marian icons constitute privileged mediations in the economy of the Church. So these are all paintings, and you can see them mirrored in the heavenly sphere. As Georg Henkel and David Gantz have recently argued, despite the emphasis the Council of Trent asserting that images do not ever contain any particular virtue in themselves and they should be venerated only insofar as the movement of the soul is referred to their prototypes, the practice of the Roman Church ran in a quite different direction. Several recent studies have started to explore in detail how some of the most important shrines venerated in the Catholic Europe, sacred images usually considered from evangelical times, whether painted by St. Luke, miraculously found or brought to earth by angels, all these images experienced an important revival since the mid-16th century and dramatically after the Council of Trent. Alonso de Montúfar's reminder of the Spanish miraculous images in his defense of Guadalupe in Mexico is a very good example of what I'm saying. But the problem is not only the new global geography of the Catholic Church. That's one important aspect. But there's another one, which is that the artistic culture in itself has radically transformed. This is the other aspect that, as an art historian, I feel also very much interested in analyzing. Let me bring just one final example, that of one of the oldest and most venerated Marian icons in Rome, the Salus Populi Romani in Santa Maria Maggiore. The evangelization of the New World brought the attention to the most authoritative images of the Church. In 1569, as the Duke of Alba was still struggling to bring under control the Beldenstorm in the Netherlands, south of the Alps, in Rome, a prominent figure in the recently founded Jesuit order, San Francisco de Borja, San Francis of Borja, requested permission from Cardinal Borromeo to make a copy of the famous icon under his protection, the Salus Populi Romani, that the evangelist St. Luke had painted to be used in the, and he wanted the copy to be used in the Jesuit missionary campaign. To their surprise, the canons of the Church radically refused to render it copied. It took several months of negotiations, the intervention of Pope Pius V, and the arrival of the Jesuit missionary Alonso de Acevedo from Brazil to have the canons of the Basilica convinced to let it be copied. Finally, four different exact replicas were made, and I'm insisting this thing, they're exact replicas, like just like Kocsky's copy of the van der Weyden's painting, one of which is today preserved in San Andrea al Quirinale. Although anonymous, these are exact copies, like Kocsky's, a kind of modern reproduction that was unknown to the Middle Ages. So the Jesuit Ignacio Acevedo took the rest of the images he returned to Brazil, with the unfortunate incident that his ship was attacked by Calvinist pirates. And I am so happy that Olivier Christin, who's the real expert on this, is here in the room, but also Tom Cummins, who has worked extensively, and Gulfinski on the exportation of sacred images or the problem of the sacred images in the New World, right? So it was attacked by Calvinist pirates. The story will become famous of the tragic role of sacred images in the spiritual conquest of the New World. The engravings that I'm showing you and the corresponding story come from no other than Louis Richomme, 1611. When the Calvinist attackers stepped aboard, Acevedo embraced the copy of the sacred icon. They fiercely struggled, trying to take hold of it. But as they failed to do it, the Jesuit, the friar, was thrown to the ocean and drowned, embraced to the Marian icon. An earlier depiction in the widely read Theatrum Crudilitates shows Acevedo holding tight an image of the Virgin, now a sculpture for the sake of the visual narrative, but it's an image of the Salus Populi Romani, as other of his mate Jesuits, their hands and arms amputated, I think it's a kind of brutal image, are drowning into the sea. So these precise images, those of the Salus Populi Romani, would not make it to Brazil. But many others did. And what is more important, truly important, I think, they came with a new understanding of the role of images in what I have been calling, and I would propose to be calling today, the spiritual economy of the early modern church. Thank you.